new day has dawned at the World Series of Poker main event. Almost 6,000 players have been eliminated.
Next year, I guess.
Yet there's so much work left to be done.
The main event's difficult. I mean, there's no messing around. The number of players that you have to evade, it's certainly a long shot to win it.
I mean, I have a ton of chips now, but anything can happen, especially with my style of play.
Tonight, a player who knows what it takes to go all the way finds himself in familiar territory, center stage.
People always tell me that's more difficult for me to win because the amateurs want to say, I busted Phil Hellmuth, or I played a pot against Phil. They want to tell their grandchildren that stuff.
So many possibilities, so many personalities here on day four. Back to continuing coverage of the World Series of Poker main event presented by Jack Link's Beef Jerky. We are under 1,000 players, and tonight 693 will make the money. The rest go home empty-handed.
Hey, come on, baby.
I hope I can do this. I really want to get to the final table. That's my dream. Oh, I need a lot of blessing.
Daniel Negreanu and Eric Lindgren share that dream. Neither has done it before.
And they're running out of time. They're both pushing 40.
Day four, it's money day. And rock and roll.
Dennis Phillips is trying to regain his 2008 mojo. Jeffrey Lissandro is always a force at the World Series.
When he puts on that hat, it scares small children.
Bracelet-winning amateur Sam Barnhart is still in the game.
Who doesn't root for a software data analyst?
But this is the World Series main event, and any of the remaining 852 players could wind up with the gold bracelet. Right now, American Patrick Poirier is your day four chip leader.
From Tupper Lake, New York, the crossroads of the Adirondack Mountains, great place for ice fishing.
Vanessa Russo was one of 14 women remaining.
And she's the only woman remaining currently married to Chad Brown.
Jean-Robert Ballon cracked the top 100 last year. Can he do it again?
The poor man's Phil Hellmuth, and like the poker brat, somehow I root for him.
And Mr. 2011 World Series Ben Lamb's still in it.
Looks trusting, plays tricky.
Second in chips right now, Daryl Jace.
Looks fresh and clean today, Lamb, but he still hasn't shaved.
Thousands are gone, but the remaining field is very strong. We kick off day four at our feature table. Two headliners here. Former WPT champion Martin Deknafe.
Nicknamed the Knife, he finished 13th at the O2 main event.
Also here, the man you love to hate, the man you love to watch, Phil Hellmuth. Short on chips, never short on attitude. 11-time bracelet winner with just 77,000 chips. Action on him with pocket deuces, and he's going to raise it up to 10-5.
Phil, with 3 second-place finishes at this World Series, if you asked him right now whether he'd take a runner-up finish here, he'd turn it down. I don't think his internal system could withstand a second-place finish at this main event. He'd implode!
Fold it over to a German from Greek descent, Charlampos Sousis, with pocket nines. And he will make the call from the small blind. The big blind, Matthias Mook, lays it down.
So it'll be heads up, the U.S. versus Greece. Good thing this isn't a cash game.
The amateur Sousis versus Phil Hellmuth. All right, here's the flop. It is Trey, ace, queen. Sousis still best with his nines. The amateur, though, checks to the razor.
Phil wants to get busy.
12-5.
And the pro with a continuation bet to 12,500.
Helm's usual very small ball post-flop bet.
The part-time player lays down the best hand, a time-honored tradition.
Well, when you raise pre-flop and an ace hits, it's easy to represent it. Sousis doesn't want to mess with Hellmuth here. And the poker brat seems very pleased with himself right now.
Making it this far in the main event is an accomplishment in and of itself. But if you bust out now, you still leave empty-handed. The day four task is to make the money, then evaluate what lies ahead. Norman, any words of wisdom for our remaining 852 players?
I don't do wisdom, but here's my list of don'ts for day four. Don't change your game. Be who you are, not who you're not. Don't fear the bubble. Embrace the bubble. Don't start thinking $8.7 million yet. It's early and it's still a pipe dream. And most importantly, to the players at the feature table, don't get in the way of a Phil Hellmuth tirade.
Well, I just think I need to get to the range for like an hour and then I'll be good.
Every time I go out there, it's like 5 at night, and you want to play some holes, you know?
Boy, I've seen Phil's poker tirade. I can't imagine his golf tirade.
He hates playing in a Northern European foursome.
Well, with Phil's stack, just picking up the blinds and annies is a boost to his hopes. Right now, he has king 6 of spades. He limps in for 4,000. The blinds at 2 and 4,000.
Phil limping in from middle position with a marginal hand. He does it his way.
Folded to Patrick Devlin with pocket 10s.
The governor feels badly about the situation he's put California in.
He limps in as well. Small blind folds. In the big blind, deck knave. Deck Nafe looks down at Ace Trey on the Jack Link's Beef Jerky Hole Cam.
When Deck Nafe won the WPT Championship in 04, it was worth $2.7 million, the largest live poker tournament score at that time.
A limped three-way pot. Pocket 10s for the Governator. The lead right now. 5, ace, queen, all spades. Deck Nafe checks top pair. Helmuth with the nut flush.
And Phil takes off his sunglasses to get a better look at the flop line. That is not a Joe Navarro approved.
He checks. Devlin's 10s are no good. He checks as well. Jack of hearts on the turn means two players are drawing dead to Phil Helmuth. And Deck Nafe bets into Phil, 7,000.
Yeah, since Phil checked on the flop, he gets some value here on the turn.
Action is on Helmuth. And he does raise it to 18,000. Devlin lays it down. Now back to Deck Nafe. Martin with a pair of aces and a weak, albeit meaningless, flush draw.
You see how Deck Nafe is holding his right hand on his head? He's covering up a tattoo of Dolph Lundgren that he got while on a drinking binge a couple of weeks ago.
11,000 more to call. That's what he does.
Phil quiet as a church mouse when he has the nuts.
River, 2 of clubs. No help to Deck Nafe. He checks.
No, the poker brat likes the stone cold nuts.
Phil putting together all of his orange chips, little yellow and blue. That's 36,500. And Deck Nafe quickly folds.
Phil not as talkative when he takes down a pot uncontested. That's a small blessing for the table.
So Deck Nafe gives a few chips to his fellow pro. Phil up to about 115,000 now, picking up a couple of pots early at this feature table. Not boosting his stack a great deal, and he knows he better get it going very soon. No matter how Phil does in this main event, his 11 bracelets are safe until the World Series of Poker Europe. Brunson and Chan have already been eliminated from this main event.
A lot of people think Phil Ivey will be the one eventually at the top of that list. He's got to work on his game, though.
He's got to start playing the game. At an outer table, 2-time bracelet winner Umberto Brenes at risk. His kings bumped into aces. Brit Mike Ellis trying to knock off Umberto. The flop is no help to Umberto.
It's my happy birthday. I'm the king.
Ellis, a bracelet winner, didn't expect a dinner show here tonight.
Moneymaker, remember Moneymaker. Give me a king. It was
turn card, not a king.
Brenes looking for a king. Ellis looking for headphones or a knockout.
The river card is an ace. An ace is full. Takes out Umberto Brenes.
That's a shame.
No. I see you on the next. Okay, my friend. Take it.
All right. Now that's worth something.
Ellis wins a souvenir with that pot. And DeShark goes down in flames.
Okay, guys. Good luck.
If Brenes had stretched that out any longer, he might have made the money. Welcome back to the Rio for more of the World Series of Poker main event. Let's check in right now with Kara Scott for an overview of this day four.
Poker players all over the world dream of winning the main event of the World Series of Poker, and while we won't be crowning a champion today, 693 players take that next step as we head into the money and the top 10% of the field. Three former champions are still in, Barry Johnston, Robert Barconi, and of course Phil Helmuth on our feature table. Phil's also trying to hold on to the lead in the Player of the Year race, so let's see what happens.
And the Player of the Year race does not end here with the main event. The 7 bracelet events coming up at World Series Europe will decide who ends up in the top spot.
5 past Player of the Year winners still alive. 140 players from the money. Minimum payout, almost twice the buy-in. At an outer table, 2005 Player of the Year Alan Cunningham holds pocket jacks. He just raised Dana Weeks all-in. She holds 6-5 off and her last 12,005 in the pot.
Weeks, a Canadian amateur, runs a bunch of fishing lodges with her husband, Rick.
Cunningham, the 5-time bracelet winner, began the hand with a healthy stack of about 300,000.
Don't worry, you're way ahead.
Weeks was very short stacked, three big blinds left, and decided to go with it. By the way, do not adjust your TV set at home. Allen's stripes are pulsating.
All right, so here's the flop. Weeks all in. Ace 6-4 all hearts. That's about as good as it gets. Weeks with a pair of sixes and a flush draw.
Weeks now with a buffet of outs to stay alive.
Cunningham trying to get us one closer to the money.
Heart.
Turn card.
Boom, drawing dead.
Is the eight of hearts, and Allen is drawing dead.
Thank you.
By the way, Lon, I have now figured out what to do with pocket jacks. At my home game, we play with a 48-card deck.
Oh, excellent idea, and just burn the other four. Weeks doubles to 40,000, not a big hit to Cunningham. 93 tables still in play inside the Amazon room. At one sits the man who was chip leader on the very first November Niner class, Dennis Phillips. He shoved with aces. He's up against the aces of Andrew Gilmore.
No flush. For nobody. We don't even want to see the damn cards.
We don't even
want
to do the flush.
Would have split his money and we're happy.
Phillips, of course, third at the 08 main event, then 45th in 09.
Dennis is the one at risk. Aces versus aces. Oh, two spades in there.
Well, I didn't have a spade, so go ahead and sweat.
Phillips now safe to stay alive.
Oh, another spade. Oh,
there's the sweat card.
Dennis with a flush draw.
I don't even want to see it. I don't want to win it that way. I do. Don't put a spade out.
The river. No spade.
I lied. Put a spade on.
They will chop the pot.
Wow. We knew you were using reverse psychology on the poker
you
guys there.
Lon, do you have any idea what the odds are for two players at a nine-handed table to be dealt pocket aces?
No, I do not.
I don't know either, but the chances are not very good. Let's just leave it at that.
Well, you can see the fear in Gilmore's eyes before that river card fell.
That's the first time this tournament I've got aces.
Me too.
Oh, man. Son of a buck. Oh, well. At least we didn't lose.
When you saw me raise, you had me smelling like crazy.
Oh, I thought you had kings. Kings, yes. I'd love you to have the ace king there.
Oh, Dennis Phillips will stick around. Looking at the overall leaderboard, two players over a million. Poirier and Daryl Jace lead the way. In sixth place, the dangerous Sebastian Rutenberg. He finished 16th in this year's 50K Poker Players Championship. At the secondary table, the chip leader, Patrick Poirier, who is feeling the weight of his main event success.
Pressure mounts every day, mostly because of the people that are supporting me. I feel like I don't want to let them down, and now I'm chip leader. My name's out there. And everybody, my Facebook's exploding, all the social media's exploding, and I just don't want to let people back home down.
Poirier, an Army vet, served 2 years in Korea, came to Las Vegas to attend UNLV, and stayed for the poker.
Boy, the game's difficult enough not to have to carry the baggage of being the chip leader. Guillaume Darcourt in seat one with a pink hair.
Do not adjust your TV set. Actually, Darcourt's hair goes nicely with Sam Barnhart's shirt.
He folds over to Barnhart with 6-5 of diamonds.
The 51-year-old taking a year off from work to test the poker waters.
He's a bracelet winner via his World Series Circuit National Championship victory, a raise to 11,000. On Wilson with pocket sevens, and the Canadian makes the call, our chip leader with ace-six of clubs. Poirier with a re-raise to 25,500.
That's a small re-raise. If Poirier doesn't want to let people down, maybe he should man up and three bet like a man.
Over to the small blind, Stuart Tuvey from Sunnyvale, California, lays it down. And Frenchman Johan Zowie lays it down as well. Now back to Barnhart.
While Barnhart is thinking, I am staring at Darcourt's hair.
Poirier with the re-raise of Barnhart's original raise to 11,000. And Sam calls.
Sam getting 4-1 on his money to see a flop. And now Wilson would be getting 5-1 to see a flop.
14,005 to call, and so the big stack could not scare the other two off. He needs to work on that.
This flop, Lon, is going to affect at least three lives.
All right, here it is. 8-5-8, Barnhart Paris's five. He checks. Wilson's pocket sevens with the eights now. Have the lead. He checks. And there's some big stack chutzpah. 40,500.
A call.
Barnhart tags along. Now Wilson. lays down.
The best hand says goodbye. And the other two hands are thinking, boy, I just got to get rid of one more guy.
All right, heads up to the turn. Four of diamonds. Barnhart's still good with his fives and eights, and he's got straight and flush draws.
He would have a straight flush draw, but we saw the seven of diamonds fold.
Sam checked it. Now Patrick tries to scare off the software analyst with 70,000.
A second barrel. But Barnhart, besides having two pair, which happens to be the best hand, has straight and flush draws.
And 70,000 is the stubborn call from Barnhart. And these two will see a river. The chip leader against the amateur. River card. Tray of clubs. Barnhart's hand is best. And he checks it again. And Patrick gives up. And Sam shows the best hand.
And Sam takes down a nice pot.
A nice read by Barnhart. I imagine he picked up some respect at this table at the expense of Poirier, perhaps.
Patrick thinking, where did it all go so wrong?
Yeah, it gives up some chips. Barnhart building a stack for a deep run, trying to repeat a performance from earlier this summer.
I'm Sam Barnhart from Little Rock, Arkansas. I won the national championship circuit event. It was a $300,000 first place winner. It was an excellent attack start off. That event there was the most aggressive event I've ever played in. I am from Arkansas, and we have a tendency to to be aggressive at times.
I'm all in.
I had to battle constantly. Some of these players do it for a living. I don't. To win the first and the last event, oh, that would be a dream come true. And that's my goal. And I'll fight everything I can to get it.
Didn't know Arkansas was an aggressive poker haven. Maybe it's the Scandinavia of America.
Action folded around to Barnhart on the button. Your kind of guy. He used to play stud all the time, but turned to hold him. A raise to 11,000 with ace tray of clubs. Now to the big blind, John Wilson, ace six of spades.
Wilson listening to K-Rock in his right earbud and smooth jazz in his left earbud.
He needs something to calm his nerves. He does make the call. He is the short stack here at this table, starting the hand with 162,000. Heads up to the flop, ace four, tray all hearts. Wilson with just top pair checks it. Barnhart with top and bottom pair bets 30,000. Neither player with a heart.
I'm all in.
All in.
Wilson all in. Oops.
Wow, the 22-year-old Canadian gets a little frisky there.
Maybe steaming from that last hand we saw when he gave up the best of it.
Barnhart with a tough decision here. Remember, we saw him lay down Pocket Kings pre-flop on day three.
But reluctantly calls.
An ace.
Let's see it.
I got two pair.
Yeah, Barnhart has Wilson in trouble. He's at risk also.
Oh, wow. Man,
good call. I hate that play by Wilson. All in. 36 big blinds left. I just think it's high risk, not high reward.
Turn deuce of spades gives Wilson a winning straight draw and four more outs.
Wilson now is going to need a 4, 5, or 6 to stick around.
The river card is a 9. Barnhart fades all trouble, eliminating John Wilson.
Hi, man.
A couple of nice pots for Sam Barnhart. Barnhart struggles with his decisions, but he's made the right decision each time we've seen him.
Wilson says his goodbyes, and Sam Barnhart stacks the chips. So Barnhart now pushing Patrick Poirier for the tournament leadership. Barnhart making a push to a million, trying to book in the first bracelet with the last.
Period.
Welcome back to Las Vegas, home of the World Series of Poker main event. This tournament is a grind. To make the final table, you need to survive 8 days. Today is day 4. Here is a quick recap of the first 3 days. We started with 6,865 players, third largest ever main event field. The leaders from the previous days are all still alive. All but three of the past main event champs are out, including the defending champ, Jonathan Duhamel.
$8.7 million to the winner line.
Folded to Jared Zito, amateur from Illinois, with King 10 off, a raise to 9,500.
He's a carpenter.
Charlempus Sousis with deuces. Now he's going to play, so now I got to say Sousis is deuces the whole hand. He calls for 9,500.
That's beyond your skills.
Matthias Mook from Germany with pocket tens just calls.
As the bubble approaches, many tend to play passively, and there you see Mook just calling with those pocket tens. When I cashed earlier at the World Series line, I was very aggressive as the bubble
approached.
Thank
you for pointing out your cash. Three players will see this flop. Four, queen, four. Zito got no help.
That flop not only missed all three players, Lon, it missed everyone in Clark County.
Zito checks, Sousas checks, Book checks as well. Jack of diamonds. Zito now open-ended. And he has chips. He's going to bet this time $11,000.
Yep, I would bet it, and that could end it.
Sousas makes a call. Mook, with the best hand, gets out of the way.
The best hand takes leave once again.
So now Sousas' deuces are best right now.
You can do it.
All right, Zito and Sousas, river card. Jack of spades. Sousas just got counterfeited with Jackson fours on board.
And neither player is happy with that card.
Zito checks. Sousas will bet $24,000.
Wow.
And Zito gets out of the way.
No hand, good read, nice play. The semi-pro takes advantage of the amateur.
Sousas had the worst of it almost the whole way, but will drag the pot. Yeah, that's worthy of some self-congratulations. For a quick reaction on that hand, let's check in with two-time Bracelet winner Greg Mueller for our pro analysis.
Sousas, I like the way he played the hand. He had a pair, he went set mining, he missed, he used his position wisely, but on the river he realized he could not win this pot. When the board double paired, and he had deuce high, he showed a little heart and fire. Sometimes, it's not who has the best hand. Sometimes, it's who's got the biggest heart.
Unfortunately, my strategy is no hand, no heart, no chips.
824 players remaining. Day four will be payday for 693. At an outer table, one-time Bracelet winner David Bach could be tweeting, "My pocket kings just got cracked by D. Friedman, who flopped a set of queens."
D. Friedman, wife of Bracelet winner Prahlad Freeman, here in great position to double up to a very comfortable chip stack.
Both these players started with almost even stacks. Friedman, the one at risk. Turn card, a king, and a better set for Bach.
And now Bach, the 0950K horse champion, about to send D. Friedman home.
The river card, the 10 of spades, and that will do it. D. Friedman knocked out of the main event.
D. Friedman got lucky there for a moment on the flop. And you hate getting busted by a man getting a massage.
Well, that should boost David's spirits. He barely had Friedman covered, so Bach doubles his stack after a lucky turn card. All right, let's get back to the secondary table. They are currently playing eight-handed, but still a lot of chips in play here. Over 4.3 million. Poirier, of course, the leader with 1.3 million. Barnhart in second place. The short stack with 112,000 is Daniel Toffel. Under the gun is Barnhart on the Jack Lynx beef jerky hole cam, king seven off.
I love beef jerky.
He lays it down, folded over two, our chip leader with pocket fours.
He got the day four chip lead by playing a lot of hands. There's no reason he's not going to play pocket fours.
He says the discipline he learned in the army helps him in poker. He raises to 8,500. 2V now on the button. Seven deuces not going to play. Now to Dark Core with Jack 8 in the big blind, and he makes the call.
With the big blind discount, he'll play those rags.
Flop 10 at tray 9. Dark Core is favored with the open-ended straight draw and the two overs to the pocket pair of Poirier. Dark Core checks, 11,500 from Patrick.
Dark Core definitely getting the right price to call in this spot.
And if you're wondering, the pink hair is the result of a lost prop bet. No details disclosed. He did make the call. Queen of spades on the turn. That hits Dark Core as he gets a queen high straight. He checked it. Poirier checks. Ten of hearts. Poirier was drawing dead.
And now Dark Core thinking, let me see if I can actually get a call here.
He's putting some chips together. 22,500.
My call.
Poirier calls. And Dark Core will take that pot. So Poirier giving away some more chips as Dark Core will get a little stronger.
My man from Tupper Lake is letting people down, including me. Buck up, son.
Poirier started day four in the top spot, but he's learning firsthand it's much tougher to remain on top. More to come from day four, the 2011 World Series of Poker main event. Welcome back to the Rio and the World Series of Poker, where Daryl Jace has taken over the top spot. You know, the most World Series bracelets won by anyone since the poker boom began belong to Jeffrey Lissandra with five. And right now, Lissandra has his last 53,000 in the middle with 6-5 of clubs, trying to double through Lance Steinberg's ace-king.
Lissandra pushed from the button with 13 big blinds left.
So this former player of the year is behind and at risk. The flop is Trey 10 King. Lissandro still at risk and further behind.
Lissandro all but gone.
Turn card the eight of diamonds, and now Lissandro drawing dead and eliminated and makes his quick exit.
Lissandro not one to hang around for chit-chat and small talk.
So Steinberg knocks off a very tough player. Lissandro finished 17th in the 06 main event, goes out short of the money here. At another outer table, another former World Series Player of the Year. Daniel Negreanu took those honors in 2004. He just flopped top pair and bet $18,000 into Dennis Belyadal, who picked up an up-and-down straight draw. Belyadal sitting just to Daniel's left.
Belyadal, a 24-year-old Swedish pro. And the player seated to his left was, I believe, my roommate in college, and I don't remember him even having a beard then.
Belyadal makes a call for $18,000, and Daniel wonders why he called there. Ten of diamonds, Negreanu with top pair, and he checks.
I'm a little surprised Daniel willing to give his opponent a free card here.
And Belyadal checks behind. River card, and there is the straight for Belyadal.
Belyadal with a kid poker type of hand brings it home.
Daniel checks again, this time a wise check.
Daniel checks and then checks out Belyadal.
And with the straight, the Swedish player, wow, puts together a pot-sized bet.
What in the world is going on? Count that. Oh my goodness. I was going to insta, but then you bet too much. You might have just lost me.
Belyadal bets the size of the pot. I assume he made the big bet there to make it look like he's bluffing.
Five plus eight.
And this would be for 80% of Daniel's remaining stack.
We have 8-5 of spades.
He's on the right track.
Yep. Usually is.
I guess you have 8-5 of spades. I'll let you have it.
Daniel folds top pair.
Daniel had the right idea. His overall game wanders from time to time, but when Daniel's game is on, his reads are spot on.
I couldn't possibly have anything if you played like that that didn't hit the river. You obviously hit the river. You had a straight, I'm sure.
I've always wondered.
You had a straight for sure. No, for sure.
I was going to say possibly.
You had a straight. Okay, but I had you till the river. But I made a good lay down. Pat myself.
Daniel, very sure and very right.
Daryl Jace, the chip leader. If he wants advice on how to win the event, only three people left can give it to him. One of them is Robert Barconi, the 2002 champ in the hand right now.
That was a $2 million score that year, and he also finished 177th in the 07 main event.
Also alive in this main event, Barry Johnston, the 86 champ.
What a legacy. Most main event cashes ever 10, and in a nine-year period starting in 1982, he made four main event final tables.
And, of course, the 89 champ, the poker brat Phil Hellmuth. Phil has a bad rap at the table, perhaps deservedly so, but at home he's a very different person.
Phil Hellmuth Jr., 47 years old, Palo Alto, California. Okay, we're at the side of my house right now. Now look at the size of this lemon. This might be the biggest lemon that a lot of people out there have ever seen before. So in Italy, they actually eat the shells. Wow, I rarely do this, but it's really not bad. You know, the poker world, you're running 100 miles per hour. I come back here to Palo Alto, I get to relax. But the worldwide public knew that I wasn't the guy that I looked like I was. I think people would be like, wait a minute, Phil's just always an ass. He's always an egomaniac. He's always this. Within the poker world, I think everybody loves me. You know, I'm authentic. I don't lie to people. People would be shocked to know that I've been a part-time poker player for 7 or 8 years. You know, I've written books and I've gotten involved in different businesses. I really like it here, and I've been able to build a life outside of poker.
I'm sorry, was that a bust of Phil Hellmuth in Phil Hellmuth's home? I've got to assume his bedroom has a mirror on the ceiling.
Phil with 8-7 off makes a raise to 9,000. I met one of Phil's sons, tall, polite, college bound. So Phil's doing something right.
Everything skips a generation.
Over to Devlin now. Pocket sixes, he makes the call.
By the way, I'm no Joe Navarro, but when Phil said the lemon was really not that bad, his face looked like he wanted to spit it into the Palo Alto City incinerator.
Hellmuth and Devlin, heads up. We'll see a flop. 8-8-4, trip eights for Hellmuth. Devlin got none of that in checks.
Well, Phil won't slow play it. Instead, he'll probably make one of his small post-flop bets.
9,500. Devlin didn't hit his set, so he gives it up.
Bad luck for Phil there not to get a call.
Now the part-time poker player will take that pot. He is working on the short stack, trying to build it back up. When poker deals you lemons, well, you have to make lemonade any way you can. Welcome back to the Rio and our coverage of the World Series of Poker main event presented by Jack Link's Beef Jerky. At one of the outer tables here in the Amazon room, you see Jean-Robert Ballon, who has his opponent dominated. Ballon just bet 11,000 with ace 9 into Pim DeGutta's wheel draw.
DeGutta, a 24-year-old Frenchman, he made a final table at an earlier World Series No Limit event this year.
He makes the call. Ballon started with 117,000 in his hand, DeGutta 87,000. Turn card, king of clubs. You see the graphic shows there's a decent chance for a split pot.
But DeGutta now a slight favorite with his club flush draw.
Ballon puts together 29,000 chips.
What was that all about?
What was that all about?
Finger right there.
Oh, Jean Robert just has a wandering finger.
So DeGutta getting a count.
Ballon desperately looking for a fold here.
But he does not get it.
Well, nobody's got anything to write home about. Actually, who am I kidding? Nobody writes home anymore.
The river card now is a six. No chop. Ballon's nine plays. He has the best hand, but looks like he's giving up. He checks.
And now DeGutta can't win it unless he bets at it. Hard to bet his hand, though.
He's struggling with the decision. Ballon would probably be happy with a check from DeGutta.
I think I'm good, but I don't know if I should turn my hand through a bluff. What do you think?
Can't discuss the hand.
You can't? Then I just check.
There is the check.
Jean Robert is going to be thrilled.
No!
DeGutta, not so much.
Wow, if you turn your head into a bluff for sure. I'm not calling 7,000.
Yeah, I know that. I know that.
I was sure you were trapping me.
Well, I was. I had an ace.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I see that.
Wow. So Jean Robert will take that pot. He's up for the day to almost 166,000. All right, we check in with our secondary table where Patrick Poirier still leads. Another tough player has joined this table, Alex Camberis. He has only 30 big blinds, but he's a dangerous one as long as he has any chips.
Camberis was Card Players 2008 Online Player of the Year, still looking for his first live tournament breakthrough.
Just two World Series caches, but a whole bunch of online success, as you mentioned, Norman. Dark Horse gives it up to Sam Barnhart, who has the Jack Link's Beef Jerky wild card hand. Here you go, Norman. Make your choice.
Batting over 400, baby.
Barnhart with a raise to 13,000.
Oh, the man from Arkansas says he's aggressive, so I believe he's being aggressive here without a real hand. B or D?
Zohair Karim made the call with pocket tens. Ace 10 of hearts for Patrick Poirier.
We know Poirier is aggressive. I believe he is from Tupper Lake, Arkansas.
And he calls for 13,000. Toffel in the small blind with King Deuce lays down. Now the big blind, Fried Mulders, an amateur from Belgium with pocket eights.
Boy, what a look. That outfit. The stripes, the colors, the shades, the hair. Of course, I have to respect the mustache.
He makes the call. So four players will see this flop. One of them, Barnhart, with the wild card hand.
Jack 9 or 8-7. Book it.
You have a 50-50 chance picking two of them. All right, here's the flop, and it's all nines. Mulders with nines full of eights checks. Barnhart bets 15,000.
Of course he's betting 15,000. He's got quads or he's got nothing.
Karim with nines full of tens makes the call. Poirier also calls.
Well, that's a loose call. That Poirier's got a lot of heart, though.
Mulder's folds his full house, so three players will see the turn card.
Poirier's got to have a big heart. The way he plays, I'm sure it gets broken every few days.
All right, four of diamonds. Barnhart checks. Kareem checks. Poirier checks.
What a surprise, Lon. I'm thoroughly confused.
Five of hearts on the river. Barnhart puts out 15,000.
Oh, the old stutter step from Barnhart. He's got quads or he's got nothing.
Kareem calls. Poirier folds. Barnhart shows ace queen. Missed it.
Well, first of all, it was a tiny bet. It was going to get called. I picked the wrong nothing. Don't I get half credit?
No.
Quarter credit?
No, sorry. Kareem will win the Jack Link's beef jerky wild card hand.
It's a bum system.
To an outer table down at the far end in the black World Series of Poker shirt, you see a very tough player. Five-time bracelet winner Ted Forrest has pocket fours.
One of Ted's nicknames is Professor Backwards. He thinks differently than others, and he's usually right.
Yeah, he makes a raise to 10,500. Folded over to Cherish Andrews, 21-year-old from Pennsylvania.
She won a Heartland Poker Tour Women's Only Hosting Contest in 2010. 847 auditioned for it, and that earned her an on-air hostess role for an HPT event at Turning Stone. Would you believe me, Lon, if I told you that's how I got this job?
Somehow, no. Big blind folded, heads up to the flop. Andrews hits top pair. She's got the lead, and she checks. Forrest bets 10,000.
You don't think I could get this position because of my personality or my looks?
Doubtful.
That's a valid point.
Andrews now with the best hand and a check raise. She check raises Ted Forrest to 24,000.
Ted Forrest won three bracelets in 1993 alone, but a new age has dawned out here, sir.
He won his other two the year before. 14,000 chips to call, and that's how many chips he's riffling right now, and he puts them in the middle. So Andrews with the lead. Turn card now. Queen of diamonds. Andrews still good. She checks again.
I think Ted's call on the flop slowed her down.
And Ted will not risk another check raise. He checks behind. River card, Jack of hearts. Andrews' two pair is best. And she checks again. Now Ted bets 30,000.
Forrest hoping to take her off her hand.
Andrews calls.
Excellent call.
That was a good call, and Ted Forrest, a gentleman to acknowledge it.
Andrews takes that pot of 136,000.
She cashed three times earlier at this World Series. She can play.
Andrews wins that skirmish with one of the game's best. She moves to over 340,000. The main event dream is still alive for her and 791 others. Having already finished second in one event this summer, 11-time bracelet winner Phil Hellmuth was trying not to repeat that finish in the $10,000 Stud High-Low Championship. Unfortunately, the poker brat would have to settle for runner-up once again, this time to banker Eric Rodowig.
He played well. Give him some credit.
Bracelet 12 was not in the cards for Hellmuth this summer, who came up short in the Poker Players Championship.
I'd trade 3 seconds for a first, any day. I'm devastated. Completely devastated.
Phil has had a very successful summer so far, and Kara Scott may have uncovered part of the reason why.
Although Phil has had an incredible 2011 series, and in fact, he is the leader right now for Player of the Year with 3 second-place finishes in events, including the 50K Player Championship, he has been trying to sidestep the media. He's doing it very politely, and it seems to be a concerted effort on his part to stay focused. You can see he's almost constantly wearing those headphones. I spoke to his wife at the 50K final table. She said that this is a conscious effort on his part to stay focused, stay present at the table.
Here's a look at Phil's summer, a resume of a lifetime condensed into 2 months of poker.
Phil this summer has shown us he can play every game better than we thought, and once again he's shown us he navigates huge no-limit fields pretty well.
He had almost $1.6 million in earnings at this World Series so far, second only to Brian Rast, who won that Poker Players Championship. Phil with ace-10 of clubs made a raise to $10,500 over to Deck Nafe, who calls with Jack-10 of spades. On the Jack Link's beef jerky hole camp, Sousis with King-6 off.
I think Sousis is trying to squeeze the King-6 into a King-King.
He folds his button. Mook now lays down his small blind. Senninger in the big blind gets out of the way.
Phil always seems surrounded by alien forces.
Heads up, Deck Nafe and Phil Hellmuth. The flop, 4-queen-7 misses both. Hellmuth leads with ace-high. No continuation bet. They both check. 9 of clubs on the turn. Ace-high still best. Phil checks again. Decknaf, open-ended straight draw. It's worth 8,000.
That's a Hellmuth-esque type of wager.
Phil will make the call.
Small bet, small call.
Hellmuth ahead, going to the river. The 6 improves neither. Hellmuth ahead with the ace high. He checks.
It looks like Decknaf is picking a good spot here to outplay Phil.
The only way he can win it is to bet it. He does bet 20,500.
I'd like Phil to make this call, but if he doesn't, I'd really like Martin to show his bluff.
Hellmuth, short stacked, decides not to commit the chips, and Decknaf will take it.
And now you see Decknaf with his right hand on the right part of his face, covering up a tattoo of Mike Matisseau he got a month ago while temporarily insane.
Phil just managed to climb over the 100,000 chip mark and now falls below it once again. We have mentioned that Phil is the leader in the Player of the Year standings. Here's a look at the top 10. Ben Lamb won a bracelet this summer. Brian Rast won 2. Some of the best in the game brought their best game to the Rio for the World Series. Ben Lamb sitting at an outer table now with an open-ended straight draw against Jamie Kerstetter's ace high, which leads after the turn. Kerstetter checked.
Kerstetter, a former tax attorney, told us her mom will be psyched to see her on television, even if it's only losing massive pots to Ben Lamb all day.
Lamb checked, almost 150,000 in the pot. Deuce of clubs on the river. Kerstetter's no pair is better than Lamb's. She checks.
Well, the flush got there on the river. Ben Lamb might pretend he has one.
Yeah, that's like a party invitation to Lamb. 83,000 into Kerstetter.
She's left just with ace high, but not willing to lay it down just yet. And with good reason, he looks so trusting. Kerstetter considers herself a semi-pro. She lives in Jersey City, New Jersey, cashed in a couple of earlier World Series events this year.
She doesn't look too confident here, and she folds.
Show the bluff for the camera.
He can show a bluff if he wants.
Oh, you gotta show that. Got that long with ace high, though?
Huh? Yes.
Wow. You know, he's a PLO player, you know? You could've used that.
I thought about jamming. Could've just jammed on him. I like $20,000, too.
Ben's evil plan to own everyone's chips continues to baffle and befuddle his opponents. Daryl Jason, Patrick Poirier, 1-2 overall right now for the main event chip lead. Stephane Albertini has joined them in the exclusive Million Chip Club. Let's get back over to our secondary table where Poirier sits. First to act, Guillaume Darcourt, French businessman with just one World Series cash, but it was worth $223,000.
The 38-year-old did win a 2010 WPT title in Romania.
King, Queen of Hearts is worth a raise to $11,500. Barnhart with King Trey off. And he will lay that down. Fold it around to Poirier. He won't play this hand. Fried Mulders, the Belgian amateur with Ace Jack.
He has an engineering degree from Catholic University in Leuven, Belgium. I believe they are the Thundering Herd.
And he calls. Now to this Frenchman, former boxer Johan Zowie with Ace 4 in the big blind, and he'll come along. So 3 players, 2 Frenchmen, 1 Belgian. You know, Norman, there's still a France-Belgium rivalry on the origin of the French fry. Here's the flop. King, King, 9. Trip kings for Darcourt. Zowie checked it. Darcourt checks.
Surprised Darcourt checking the flop on a draw-heavy board.
They all check. 10 of diamonds. 2 players drawing dead to Darcourt. Zowie checked it again. Now Darcourt reaching for chips. A little less than half the pot, 17-5.
Why are the French and Belgians arguing over the origin of the French fry? I thought McDonald's invented it.
Mulders folded. Action on Zowie now. Ooh, he's thinking about something.
Maybe Zowie looking to get creative here at the wrong time.
Yeah, getting frisky with a bluff check raise to $36,500.
This would be the wrong time. I'm a self-made wrong time expert, Lon.
Guillaume Darcourt just calls. I wonder if that trips any alarms in Zowie's head. River card, the jack of clubs. Darcourt rubs it in, improving to a king high straight. Zowie checked.
And Darcourt very comfortable with his hand right now.
40,000 comfortable.
Zowie going to get creative again?
Nope, he will lay it down.
He smartly throws in the towel.
But a round too late. Darcourt got some unexpected value on the turn from his fellow countrymen. So Darcourt up to about 600,000. Let's get back now to the featured table. Phil Hellmuth is trying to make it through yet another day. Deck Nafe with King Queen off makes a raise to 11,000.
Deck Nafe played bridge growing up. He was a bridge life master in Sweden by age 21.
And once again, he's playing in some world-class bridge tournaments. Fold it over to Hellmuth. Phil with 10-8 off makes the call.
Boy, Phil looks bored and plays that rag hand from the big blind.
So he'll see a flop once again heads up with Deck Nafe. Flop 9-4, deuce each with a diamond flush draw. Deck Nafe's is better, neither paired up. Phil checks, Deck Nafe checks. Five of hearts on the turn, no help to Phil.
Looks like Phil wants to buy it right here.
12,005.
I'm all in.
And Deck Nafe snap raises Phil all in.
Wow, I didn't expect that all in, Lon. Phil didn't expect that all in. And Phil now just waiting an appropriate period of time until he folds. Deck Nafe somehow knew here that Hellmuth could not play for the rest of his chips.
And with a smirk on his face, Phil does lay it down.
Martin looked into Phil's soul. Better him than I.
So no traction early on day four for Phil Hellmuth as he now sits with just 67,000. Day four marked Phil Hellmuth's return to the feature table. And it came with a new rivalry. Start of day chip leader Patrick Poirier could not get much going.
Oh, wow.
While Sam Barnhart showed there was hope in Arkansas, the fun is just beginning for some.
But I made a good lay down. Pat myself. We'll find out on TV.
For Norman, Chad, and Kara Scott, I'm Lon McCarron. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.